There's a place at the bottom of California and at the beginning of the Sea of Cortez where sport fishing has dominated the last century, and for good reason. Protected from the swells of the open Pacific, the East Cape of Baja is a fisherman's paradise for most of the year. But in winter, as the desert interior remains warm and the water temperatures cool, the wind appears with a mighty predictability that chases most anglers away, leaving the sea open to a community of those who cherish the wind and almost worship the wind as the giver of their nomadic lifestyle. Like migrating butterflies, kiteboarders and windsurfers descend on the East Cape. And there's no doubt the kiters do go higher. A lot higher, but what about faster? Windsurfing's been around for decades, while kiting is relatively new. So now the question of who is faster over distance must be settled. The kiters have sheer power, the windsurfers have tradition and technique. So now let's find out who is the Lord of the Wind. Cabo San Lucas and La Paz, on what's known as the East Cape of Baja, lies the small town of Los Barriles, which this week is hosting the Lord of the Wind Showdown, an international kiteboarding, windsurfing, and SUP competition. Normally, Los Barriles is the quiet alternative to the nearby party town known as Cabo, but this week, it's a little different. We're starting off with shots of tequila and guys trying to rub up on the Corona girls, which is to be expected. What's not so expected are Mexican hula dancers, but around here, just about anything goes. And you can bet there will be a party going on every night of this four-day competition. And every day as the wind picks up, conveniently about 11 o'clock in the morning, the party starts on the water. This is going to boil down to a head-to-head competition between kiteboarders and windsurfers, but really, it's all about having fun and promoting this beautiful region of Baja.
We came up with this idea as a way to promote Los Barriles. This town has incredible windsurfing. It's been known around the world for a long, long time.
So we started the annual event, and this is our first annual event, which we believe will get bigger and bigger every year. Again, those funds going back in our community help support this, help keep this going, and we believe that this event will continue to grow based on the people that we've seen, the response we've gotten back, of course, the support from the media and our town. This community has gotten behind this event like no other that we've seen since we have been coming here. They're enjoying it. We have the local community on the beach. We have our spectators on the beach. It's just been outstanding to see the support.
The Lord of the Wind Showdown is based on the fact that Dan is a kiter, I'm a windsurfer. We go out and we do what we do. We are kind of competitive, so it came down to, well, who's the fastest on the water? Dan likes to think he is, or that kiters are, but I'm here to tell you that the windsurfers are pretty dang fast also. So it's a showdown, mano a mano, who's the fastest?
takes an incredible amount of planning and volunteer work to pull off an event like the Lord of the Wings Showdown, which is the largest event of its kind ever in North or South America. But now, with all of the necessities in place, what happens next is really just up to the wind to decide.
We can add less than for the forecast. If there's no clouds in the sky, we should be able to add about 5 knots to that. The better news is that the chances are it's going to keep on going right through to Saturday.
The forecast is for steady, strong winds, so the first thing today, we'll start off with the first of several big air heats, and the stronger the wind, the bigger the air.
I don't think we could have better conditions for a kiteboarding event. It's blowing solid 9-meter weather, which would be about 20 to 25 knots, and it's a beautiful day.
So the highest jump wins, but how do they know how high they're flying?
It's a 3D sports recorder, so essentially it's a printed circuit board inside of waterproof housing that tracks all your movement in three-dimensional space, so it gets all your physics data, essentially, spin rates, acceleration, g-forces, the height of every jump, distance of every jump, it gets all your edge angles in X, Y, and Z. And your hang time, so forth, and it gets your entire ride path, which can also be exported into Google Earth for a post-ride analysis to see where you rode. So it's not only what you did, but where you did it. So you're looking down here, this is a timeline, and these spikes are jumps. So all this squiggly stuff would be the swell and chop that they're riding on, and then these big spikes. So let's go down here to what's obviously a jump. And you can see that's the ride pathway. Somebody's doing a lot of spins right there. So we can back that up, spin the camera around from any direction. We can zoom way out, zoom way back in. It's like a little video game. Go right up here, get it to the top of the jump. You can see the jump height's 24.2. It may or may not be the highest. Oops, keeps going. 25.8, 26.2. 26.7 was the highest.
These are the best thing. Because otherwise, it's just me telling you how high I went. And I say, I was way up there. And you say, but of course, have you ever talked to a kiteboarder? When they jump, they say, man, I was way up there. But now that you got a shadow box, you actually know you went 36 feet way up there. And gave it a little big little board poke. So it was up to, you know, a couple extra inches, something like that. Good times, good times.
A lot of courage. I would think is the key. And being young and crazy and made out of rubber.
This event involves afternoons filled with different types of heats for both kiters and windsurfers with various forms of racing, including slalom courses.
Three, two, one, up!
The raising of a series of flags lets the competitors know when the race actually begins, and that's important because these races can mean money in their pockets.
Man down.
To be watching is worth over $600 US. This race that's on the line right here.
Most of the kiteboarders have come into this event thinking that there really is no contest between kiteboarders and windsurfers. But I think it got everyone's attention when in the first windsurfing heat, Kevin Pritchard won by a huge margin. So now is the question whether or not kiters can beat windsurfers, or is it, can kiters beat Kevin Pritchard? I ask Kevin how he can win by such a large margin.
Kind of helps to be like seven-time world champion. So, you know, paid my dues, worked hard over the years, and, you know, it definitely, on the longer course, you add up a little bit of here, a little bit there, and, you know, it's fun. These guys are still charging hard, so keep me on my toes a little bit. The showdown and the kite versus the windsurf, I don't know. It'll be interesting to see. Those guys really have a big angle, you know. When you're going downwind, they can really let it off the wind. You know, they got this big parachute up there where we, you know, we have sails and stuff like that. So it'll be interesting. You know, I think there's some pretty good guys down here, so we'll see who's the faster machine out there.
We have 3 more days of competition before the showdown, and also 3 more days of partying and the official Lord of the Wind bikini contest. We're at the Lord of the Wind showdown in Los Barriles on the East Cape of Baja. And tonight at the Hotel Playa del Sol, it's the first heat of the bikini contest. There will be a second heat coming up Saturday night, with the winner being awarded $600. A bikini contest will make you hungry, so it's a good thing Van Warmer Resorts is putting on a pig roast, and there's nothing quite like a big bonfire on the beach. But early the next morning, about 11:30, the racing has begun, and this time it's the kiteboarders going at it on a long upwind and downwind course, and again we have perfect conditions.
Hey, this is Aaron Sales with Kiteboarding Magazine. We're here in Los Barriles at the Lord of the Winds Showdown. Got some serious racing going on. These guys are cruising. Los Barriles is so awesome because the wind is pumping, the water's good, and the racing is epic.
Right now, being chased by this black Camarena kite.
Would you like some tequila?
That is the best tequila I've ever had.
It's winded, but I can definitely see Adam Cook, Damian Leroy, Sean.
This is a combined ladies and men's events with a $600 prize for each division.
These are our top lady races. Again, they're also racing for over $600. Vincent trying to get himself downwind. This could be Damian Leroy's race. Adam Cook just behind him.
Then we have John Heineken.
John Heineken's also made the turn. He's chasing. And these guys are trying their hardest. They're giving everything they've got. They're holding nothing back.
Kiteboard racing is definitely exciting to watch, and it's no wonder that it is currently under consideration to be added as an Olympic sport. The slalom course set up for the kiteboarders is the first of its kind ever and is of special interest to the Olympic officials. Who knows, maybe someday a race like this will be for a gold medal instead of $600.
Ah, bouncy and fast. Good though, had a good start. Managed not to trip an edge and crash the rest of the way down, so I'm pretty stoked. Came in first, can't be happier.
The sport of kiteboarding is growing fast, so of course there are kiteboarding schools available to teach you the basics.
Hi, I'm Ian from Exoticite Kiteboarding, and I'll give you a run through of the equipment we use for kiteboarding. We've got 4 main components. We have the board, the kite, the bar and lines, and the harness. I'm going to start by showing you how to inflate the kite, how to attach the lines to the kite, and how the safety systems work.
The reason we put air in the kites is so when they crash in the water, we're able to relaunch them. We have the main leading edge that inflates across the front here, and then the smaller struts that run back and forwards across the kite. Everything is connected together with a one pump system, so as you inflate the leading edge, everything inflates at the same time. This is the leading edge of the kite. Inside here, there's a hose that attaches the leading edge to each of the 5 struts. After we inflate, we seal each of the struts off, so if one gets a hole, the whole kite won't go flat. Carrying the kites on the beach, we always hold them by the leading edge, and the wind blows underneath the kite and floats it for us. When we're ready to store the kite on the beach, we flip it over and lay the leading edge down on the ground. Now the wind is pushing down on the canopy and holding the kite in place. Here we have the bar and lines. This is a 4-line kite, a North Evo. I'm going to unwind the lines, back up wind,
and then straighten them to take all the tangles out. There are four attachment points on a kite. There are two on the leading edge, and then two on the trailing edge, one on each side. We're always going to start by attaching the leading edge line to the inside line. The knot we use is a lark's head, or slip knot. We push this line back through, take the knot, pass it through there, tighten it, and then slide it back up against the knot. That's all we have. That holds, believe it or not. Now I'm going to do the outside line to the trailing edge. Same thing as a slip knot there. Knot on the end of the line, pass it through, tighten it. Now we'll do the same thing on the other side of the kite. Before launching the kite, the next thing I'm going to do is put my harness on. This enables us to take all the power of the kite with our body weight. So it doesn't take a lot of physical strength. We just attach ourselves to this bar here. I'm just going to put the clip in. So as I'm riding a kite, I'm always hooked into the harness. I'm never really using muscles. I just use my body weight. Okay, with the bar and lines, we have the bar itself, which is used for steering the kite. Then the chicken loop, which has a quick release on it. So we have three safety systems. The first one is pushing away on the bar. The second one is pushing a quick release away from you. And then the final one is detaching yourself completely from the kite by this release here on the leash. I will show you this with the kite in the air. Let me explain quickly, attaching yourselves to the kite. First thing we're going to do is attach your leash to the safety ring. We then clip in the chicken loop and pass the chicken finger underneath the hook so that we can't fall out of the kite. That seems a little alarming that we're constantly attached to the kite, but we have those three safeties. First one, push all the way away on the bar and let go. The kite should fall out of the air. If that doesn't work, we then come to the chicken loop, push away in a quick release, and the kite will fall out of the air. We're now going to launch the kite, and I'll show you these two systems in action. As you can see, as I'm flying a kite, all the power of the kite comes down through these center lines to the harness. The bar, the grip is very gentle. We don't need to use muscles to fly the kite. Everything is your body weight. As I explained before, the safety. The first thing we can do is let go of the bar, and the kite will very slowly fall out of the air with no power. If that doesn't work, the next stage is pushing away on the quick release. So I'm going to push this away and let go, and the kite falls out of the air with no power at all. And that's it. That's your safety. If that one didn't work for some reason, right here on the leash, push away, and if I let go of that, then the whole kite is gone. So three stages. Push the bar away, then push the quick release away from you. The final one is releasing your leash. If I was to let go of this, the kite would blow away from me and I would have no problems. I've lived in Los Barriles for 15 years. I came here for the beautiful steady wind that we have 6 months out of the year. It's a beautiful, relaxed, very gorgeous little town. If you're thinking of coming, book your tickets and come down here.
If you'd like more information about next year's event in Los Barriles, then contact the Hotel Palmas de Cortez. Palmas de Cortez is a spectacular, family-friendly resort that's close to all of the action. Great restaurants, comfortable rooms, and amazing views are just the beginning. Call or visit VanWarmerResorts.com for information.
All right, girls, are you ready?
Welcome back to Los Barriles. I'm Justin Wolf. It's another party night on the beach, and it's round two of the bikini contest with clubwear as the theme. The girls are really excited at the opportunity to win $600, and the spectators really seem to enjoy it as well. Wind sports tend to be in very good physical condition. And speaking of being in good condition, the stand-up paddleboard riders are also included in this competition. While not necessarily considered a wind sport, SUP is definitely exploding in popularity.
A lot of wind.
top.
That was fun. It's more fun to have someone in my sights.
Yeah.
Paddleboard racing has been the fastest growing sport among women over 40 and men over 50, followed by kiting. So you could see that there's a lot of interest because it really doesn't take a lot of skill to learn. I mean, basically in the first 30 minutes, you'll be standing up and paddling. When the water's glassy, it's like snorkeling because you can see the bottom of the ocean, you see the fish, and it's a great workout. You can get your biceps, triceps, glutes, do crunches, you can do sit-ups on your board, so it's really becoming popular. It's not the greatest sport in the windy conditions, but in the mornings when it's glassy, yeah, you just get a great workout. It's a lot of fun, and you're in the water.
Oh, it was wonderful. Baja, beauty. It was tough at the beginning and got worse as we continued.
All right, guys. Thank you for coming down this year to the SUP event. We had a great time. Weather was a little windy, a little challenging, but we all still had a great time. We're gonna go out, catch a few waves. Remember, next year we'll wait for you guys down here. Hopefully we'll see you for the SUP at the second annual Lord of the Wind Showdown.
I'm famous now!
With the SUP events concluded, the wind is coming up right on schedule for another full day of racing, big air, and freestyle events.
Wow, can you believe it? Check out this wind. Look at them all.
Woohoo!
He's gonna go huge!
Covered by print and online media, working with the event's official photographer.
Hi, I'm Erin Kalmes, and I'm the official photographer for the Lord of the Wind kite competition. And today we've come out on this boat to try to capture a better angle of light and to get the pros winning in the windsurfing category and the kiteboarding category.
Photographers and kiteboarders, show-offs.
Yeah, so I was out kiting and I saw the boats out there and I was like, man, I wonder, are these guys gonna let me jump them? And they gave me permission to come aboard, so I lined it up and started going for it. And I'm pretty sure I cleared it quite a few times and it was a lot of fun, exciting for sure. So I stopped before I ended up hurting myself, but it was
Andy,
awesome.
Andy, who had brought his family down for the event, was staying at the Hotel Palmas de Cortez, which is a beautiful beachside resort and headquarters for the Lord of the Wind competition. There's definitely no better place to stay in Los Barriles than the Hotel Palmas de Cortez.
Hey, how's it going? This is Andy from Transcend Kiteboarding Apparel. We're stoked to be here at the Palmas Hotel. This place is awesome when there's no wind. Obviously, you can see killer tiki bar, killer pool, beautiful view, great fishing. This is the place to be.
Everyone's having fun in Los Barriles at the Lord of the Wind Showdown. Freestyle events are always fun, and right now it's the windsurfers' turn to show their stuff.
Whoa.
the kiteboarders do their thing, and they sure come to a camera like a bee to a flower. Watching them buzz around, it's sure understandable why they have so much confidence that they can take the windsurfers. But first, they'll show off their speed in the men's and women's slalom finals.
Okay. Less than 1 minute to go to the start of this race.
But on our left, this race is the money race. This is the race that counts for everything, ladies and gentlemen. And you can see how close this is. Oh, and here we go.
Adam, keep going.
Adam, keep going. Be careful. Adam, Jamie Leroy is now pulled out into first place. Roberts is in fourth. He's so, so close.
This is the first slalom course of its kind for any kiteboarding event, and it sure gives the kiters an opportunity to give the spectators an exciting race.
Brian is in third, and Roberts is in third. He's trying to catch Adam Cook, but Adam Cook is fast.
The conditions seem to be perfect, and it appears that the kiteboarders are on top of the world.
Unfortunately, Robert just had a little bit of trouble getting around, but it is good.
Feels good. Pinch me, I think I'm dreaming.
Good, it's fast. Tight in there. A lot of down kites, really tight. A little bit of blocking out going on. I guess that's racing, right? So, yeah.
The women's action is just as competitive with the same money up for grabs.
Over $600 US. This race that's on the line right here. Unofficially, of course, that this will be the finals. Final, but as it stands, we have four girls on the water, one of them coming away with $600. Kristen, of course, being one of the local girls supporting this town. She flew in from Hawaii to be at this event, but she's kind of here many, many times. One of them, Molly Cottagrove, the thing about her feeling is that she has a couple of dogs, some puppies that are available looking for good home.
Beach, the kiters and windsurfers have been strutting around like prize fighters before the big fight. The conditions are perfect and the machines are tuned. When we return, we will find out who is the Lord of the Wind. Welcome back to Baja California. I'm Justin Wolf. It's been a week of incredible competition and even more incredible partying.
Somebody play some reggae music.
take. I hope somebody brings a bunch of booze. And I hope that we're gonna have a party. Yes, I hope that we're gonna have a party. And I hope nobody gets hurt.
Nobody here today can make a petition.
This is a huge race, ladies and gentlemen, worth a lot of money. So when they come down, go ahead and cheer for them. Though these racers, they all think that everything will be determined here at the start.
It's finally time for the showdown, a grueling 6-mile round trip head-to-head race between the kiters and the windsurfers.
The red flag is a 4-minute warning, up for 1 minute and then down.
15.
Then the yellow flag up for 1 minute, and down, and the green start.
3, 2, 1.
And we're off! The race is the start. Looks like we have wind forever down the front. Going off to the ground line. I'll pass it over to Jason real quick. In front, while the wind river is a little bit ahead, the front of the guy, one of some of the riders, Adam Cook and John Heidman on those two.
Like those two spiders, we're gonna eat like kings.
I know it's gonna be a kiter.
Well, Dan ought to turn around, because that's not a kite. That's Kevin Pritchard, who's so far ahead, the crowd's having a hard time spotting second place. In fact, by the time the first place kiter closed in on the finish line, Kevin Pritchard was already on the beach talking to me.
Yeah, we just had a kite versus windsurf race, and it was like 3 miles upwind, and super windy, good conditions, great conditions down here in Baja, and stoked to come out on top. Earlier on, they were, the kiters were kind of giving us and talking about us, and then we kind of showed them who's boss. I don't even think the other guys have finished yet, so pretty good.
I'm not sure everybody understands that Kevin Pritchard, windsurfer, winning Lord of the Wind means to the entire windsurf community, not just here in Baja, but worldwide. I mean, we've been listening to kiters talk smack for years and years and years about who's fastest, but finally, we got the right man for the job, and he didn't just win, I mean, he spanked him. It wasn't pretty, it was the ugliest spanking I've seen. I mean, since I was 2, I haven't seen a spanking like that before, man. Like, bent him over the knee and gave him like twice across. It was a thing of beauty, literally a thing of beauty. And, you know, now we're just waiting for the kiters to kind of trickle on in.
We just had the Lord of the Winds showdown, final race. Kiters versus windsurfers for $3,500, and it's windy. And it was a long, grueling race. One of the windsurfers ended up beating us. But I won the kites, and pretty happy to be finished, because that was a grinding race. But I won, and then Damo came in second, and Adam in third, and we were all had an amazing battle upwind, trading tacks the whole way, and then I was able to get Adam on the downwind, grounded in second at the top mark. So it was fun, stoked to be here, and conditions were perfect for it, so, yeah.
I mean, they can just tax so much harder up wind, you know? We just had such big kites, it was so hard to hold an edge. Like, we had 12 and a half inch fins still pushing it out, you know? So, it was fun. It was a good time.
It was crazy, it was shocking. I can't believe that windsurfer beat everybody. Same.
Congratulations to Kevin Pritchard. And with this year's awards passed out, you can count on an even more intense competition next year.
Welcome everyone, we're down here in the Lord of the Winds Showdown.
in Los Perales, Mexico, where we just had four awesome days of competition with windsurf, kiting, bikini contest. We had beer, they had free tequila shots. Everyone had a great time. I know I'm gonna be here next year, and I hope that I can see you here in Los Perales, Mexico.
After this break, we'll have more from the Lord of the Wind Showdown. Plus, we'll explore some of the other things you can do while visiting Los Perales. And we'll also find out who won the bikini contest. On the way to Los Perales from the airport, you'll see this big white ball, which means you're crossing the Tropic of Cancer, and you're now officially in the tropics. The East Cape is its own unique tropical paradise, with beautiful things to see everywhere you look. This region is also world famous for its sport fishing opportunities that can be just as good as the windsurfing. Just outside of Los Perales, Van Warmer Resorts has constructed an amazing zipline course that's good for an incredible morning or afternoon of fun in a beautiful arroyo. If you decide to visit this area for the windsurfing or kiteboarding, be sure to take advantage of everything else the area has to offer. And be sure to take advantage of the incredible wind that makes this place special for kiteboarders and windsurfers. Only wait until next year to see if the kiters can avenge their loss. Will they bow to a superior machine or retool and rethink their strategy? Regardless, it'll be a whole lot of fun, guaranteed.
Oh, they're feeling so high right now.
Cheers, Mike.
And congratulations to Claire Lutz, winner of the Lord of the Wind Bikini Contest. If you you'd like more information about next year's event in Los Perillas, then contact the Hotel Palmas de Cortez. Palmas de Cortez is a spectacular, family-friendly resort that's close to all of the action. Great restaurants, comfortable rooms, and amazing views are just the beginning. Call or visit VanWormerResorts.com for information.